Let's go into Rob's question. He has a question about VO2 max training, and I think it's a really good one. So Rob says, VO2 max training, how do I know if I'm doing it correctly? VO2 max workouts are definitely the ones I struggle with the most in terms of knowing if I'm doing the right thing. And I've experimented with a few approaches, short shorts, favorite of Chad. Chad's mentioned that before. What do we mean by short shorts, Chad? We should describe that or explain that.
I mean, it's, it's the only
not
way.
Volleyball shorts.
Yeah.
Not volleyball shorts.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's basically the only way I can do VO2 max work because it's the least painful version of it. So you work for a short period of time and then you recover for either a time match or a slightly shorter period of time and then just repeat ad nauseum. Emphasis on nauseum. Yep.
While wearing short shorts. No, I'm just kidding.
Yes. So we're talking like 30-30s, right? Something like that.
Yeah. 30-30s, microbursts, 15-15s, all sorts of options, hard starts followed by a proliferation of a bunch of repeated efforts like we just described. But the idea being is that you, over the course of these repeated efforts, increase your aerobic uptake.
And how high are your bib shorts rolled up when you do this, Jack?
Typically? Oh, boy. Short as I can get them. It's obscene. Cool. That's why I work out alone.
That's great. So Rob then also says there's the other side of doing things, which is long and low, like 106%. Like you're just tipping up into VO2 max range. You're still likely also in threshold range. Remember, your body is not a system of switches. It's a system of faders, right? So, but he's talking lower end of VO2 max. And he says, and recently he's also been trying hard starts. So the concept of this is that you will start much harder than VO2 max. And then thereafter you'll settle into likely, depending on the duration, it might be a higher percentage or lower percentage of VO2 max, but you'll spike. And then after that, you'll settle in quotes here at VO2 max, as comfortable as that can be. So Rob says, when I first tried VO2, all I did was try to maintain the power target, typically somewhere around 120%. Well, and that depends. Like 120% is a commonly prescribed value, but there's plenty of space that you can explore within the VO2 max range. He says, then on researching, it seems like power, and this is Rob's assumption. I want to make this clear that this isn't necessarily like a takeaway or something that we're saying is gospel. He says, then on researching, once again, lots of responsibility in researching, it seems like power is just a way to push your oxygen uptake and you should gun for anything above 90% max heart rate is a proxy for oxygen uptake. This is when it gets really tricky, is when you're starting to look into heart rate and then power to be able to achieve the same outcome. It gets complicated. So he says, I've been experimenting with hard starts. I go way over the power target for a brief period and get my heart rate up really high above 90%, then back off the power and just keep my heart rate up. There's a whole thread on the forum where he saw this being debated. The forum, trainerroad.com/forum, you can go there and have awesome discussions with lots of different cyclists. So go do it. He says, but this does fatigue my legs and often I'll end an interval at threshold or sweet spot power, although my heart rate is still roughly somewhere around 90%. So is this still VO2 max training? It'd be great to understand what I should be aiming for and any physiological signs I can check to see if I'm on the right track. Great show. I've learned so much about cycling over the past couple of years and it was great help during the various lockdown periods when turbo training was the only thing available. Cheers from Rob. Rob, I'm excited to answer this one. You, Rob, like me and like many others, we are incredibly skilled at overthinking things. And this is one great example, like when you're talking about looking for physiological markers to see if you're doing it while you're literally doing VO2 max training, you're wondering if you're doing it. So this is, once again, a great sign of us cyclists. We're fantastic at that. And
this is
like
part
you-
of. Oh, right, I was gonna say, this is part of why I love the podcast. It's an outlet for my overthinking. It's so fun.
Exactly. Totally. Yep. I like that. So you covered this, Rob, and we'll cover this too here, but there are different ways to go about accomplishing VO2 max training. Totally. It's a range that you have to work within and there's different ways to do it. Chad was talking about short shorts. We talked about longer, more extended ones. There's Amber's absolutely favorite workout of 5x5 VO2, which Amber has mentioned before is the least favorite thing that she does not look forward to doing after mm-hmm. doing it for so many years. So there's a lot of different things, but Chad, can you cover what the goal is? So then we can kind of have like a common thing to understand or an objective for all these different ways to accomplish VO2 max training. What is the point of VO2 max training?
Just to increase your aerobic capacity. So we're trying to be able to do as much work as possible by utilizing the aerobic system, so the endurance system. And you mentioned all of the the power levels, you know, 102 to 120 and beyond, and you can improve your aerobic capacity working at 60% as long as you do it for long periods of time. So we're just trying to, if you think of it less in terms of the workout and the numbers and more in terms of the physiological adaptations that are actually driving what we're after, this is the nature of VO2 max work, aerobic capacity work. We're trying to improve the things we talk about often, the oxidative enzymes, the mitochondrial health and quantity and robustness, the capillarization in the muscle itself, so we can perfuse it with more nutrients, more oxygen. And we can do this in so many ways. We can run the whole spectrum from the easiest of work extended out over long durations to the hardest of work for short, almost the hardest of work for short durations. And then for the truly hard work, but only done like in the, just like we talked about with the short shorts, where you bury yourself and then you ease up and you bury yourself and you ease up, where you can use power outputs at 150% of threshold, which doesn't look anything like aerobic work, but the outcome of the workout is largely an aerobic benefit.
That's a really important thing to get to understand there, is that there's ways to put yourself in that spot where you're getting aerobic benefit that aren't just one specific zone. I mean, that's, you get aerobic benefit all the way down from Z2 all the way up, right? So there's a lot of different ways to accomplish
this. Sprints, 30 yep. second sprints. Yep.
Yep. Once you exhaust those anaerobic stores, you're just left with aerobic capabilities thereafter, right? So that's,
and the stimulus on the aerobic fibers is still felt. I mean, it's, you can, we use the term, and I see it in the notes, many ways to skin a cat. And when it comes to aerobic conditioning, there are many ways.
Yeah, absolutely. Amber, what does VO2 max training feel like? Because this is another thing we're talking about. There's a lot of different ways to accomplish it, but what does VO2 max training in particular feel like for you?
Terrible. Pretty much that's how you know you're doing it right, honestly. And the thing that's frustrating about these is, even when you get good at them, it just means that you have to put out more power. It doesn't, it's that old saying of, it doesn't get easier, you just get faster. And it's true. I mean, your body is going to continue to adapt as you improve, but that just means that in order to elicit the same stimulus, like we've said before, you're going to have to push a little bit harder. And it's, there's honestly, there's no easy way to do VO2 max efforts. Because if it feels easy, it's not VO2 max. I hate to break it to you.
It's true. I was cracking up yesterday because one of the athletes, she commented on her ride, to me, it was a VO2 workout that I gave her. And she commented, "I did a good job on this, but I hate VO2. Yep. And I just cracked up, and my comment back started with, "So you did the workout right."
Yep. That's how you know you nailed it. Exactly.
Yep. Yeah.
So Hannah, so once again, we're talking about aerobic training, right? That's the basis of it. VO2 max is a very, like, you can get a whole lot of it in terms of, you know, a lot of focus time at that peak aerobic uptake and everything else. Takes a long time to get to that if you're at lower endurance levels. But Hannah, do you change or periodize your VO2 work, so to speak, depending on where you're at in the season? In other words, do you do different types of VO2 max intervals depending on the time of year?
Yeah, I think there are so many different types of VO2 max intervals. You know, you can do shorter ones, you can do longer ones. You know, we're talking 1 minute to 5 minute type of things. You can do even shorter ones with shorter recovery, like 30-30s. You can do recoveries that are 1-to-1 rest. You can do 2 minute intervals with 8 minutes rest. So there's just so many different types. And I think it really depends what type of adaptations you're after and what type of racing you're doing. So I think, you know, a standard periodization would be to start at shorter intervals with longer rests and then increase the duration of the intervals. And then there's also, of course, you can go the direction of decreasing rest as well. I also think that it's valid to note that it depends what you're measuring, and that's going to influence how you feel or what you're looking at. So there's, I mean, we could measure VO2 just based on heart rate. We could measure it just based on power zones. We could even get blood lactate testing going. And in all of these cases, you know, for example, if you're just using heart rate and you're doing 2 minutes on, 2 minutes off, you might be at, you know, VO2 range the whole time and achieving some type of cardiovascular element. If you looked at your power for those though, you might be decreasing 20 watts every interval, where at the end of that workout, you're not in your VO2 power range, you're in your threshold power range. And so, you know, VO2 is a really interesting one in that regard, but I think it depends, you know, are we getting the muscular effect, or are we getting the cardiovascular effect? And the golden area is where we can get all of those. And I think that's when you're really, at least for me, I feel like that's when you're really doing a great job with your VO2 work, is you're able to do all of those successfully in one workout. But that's why personally, I like to view VO2 as an energy system, because I feel like when I do VO2 max work, more than any other type of training zone, I know that if I'm at least achieving one of those things in the workout, I'm getting some sort of benefit. So unlike threshold, where if I'm not hitting the numbers, but my heart rate is through the roof, I'm not really achieving threshold. But if in VO2, I'm going to the absolute best of my abilities and I'm still not hitting the numbers, I know that I'm still stressing my cardiovascular system appropriately.
Hannah, you just built out the perfect advertisement for adaptive training, because that's exactly how it works.
Good. I'm glad to hear it.
Yes. Thank you. Ad break.
We'll mail the check later.
Yeah, exactly. We don't have advertisers on this podcast. So that was it. That was fantastic. But that's just the thing of keeping yourself in that, and I can't use the word sweet spot because it would conflate here in this case, but in keeping yourself in that VO2 max productive zone. You can't just go out and do 5x5 right off the bat. You have to work your way into it. And that's why we built out progression levels with these workouts. And then they're all calculated and analyzed via AI so that you're stepping up at the right amounts. You're always in that bandwidth that Hannah talked about. It's the way to do it. Also, welcome to DC Rainmaker, who's in our live chat. I'm sure he's here for protein. I'm sure that's what he's super interested in hearing us talk about today. So
that's why everyone's here.
Yeah, exactly. It's really easy to get in the weeds with VO2 max, and honestly, any type of training, but VO2 max in particular is really easy to get in the weeds.
Wait, but we get in the weeds on things?
Yeah, join us. Yeah, water's fine. But here's the main thing that at least I personally keep in mind. I'm going after trying to accumulate time at peak aerobic uptake. When it's taken care of. Whereas before, I'd like just cherry pick a workout. I'd be like, hey, that looks great. I can do it. And I'd usually, but in the old for me a whole, and what I end up prioritizing is at that peak aerobic uptake. And the one thing I will say is as I get closer to an event, I will specialize further. So my VO2 max work might look a little bit more variable if I'm going toward like a crit or something like that. And it's more repeated or something, you know, it might be more race specific, but those hard starts that you mentioned in this case, Rob, can be really difficult to be able to achieve a lot of time at peak aerobic uptake. And the reason for that is because you'll exhaust anaerobic stores and you'll just work yourself on those short efforts. Let's just say theoretically that you could hold 5x5 VO2. So you get 25 minutes roughly, I don't know, let's just say 20 minutes out of that at peak aerobic uptake. If you're going to sprint and then settle in, you might not be able to hold that 20 minutes or whatever else by the end of that workout. You might not have accumulated quite as much. You might get to peak aerobic uptake earlier, but you might be able to sustain it for less time thereafter. So it's just something to keep in mind. Typically what Chad is thinking about when Chad is designing all the plans and when we're going about our training is he wants you to be really good at dwelling there. And he knows that really good things happen when you're at peak aerobic uptake in terms of adaptation. So it's just trying to find the best way to get you there and keep you there. So you're on the right track, Rob. Don't overthink it and just, you know, use adaptive training and it'll solve everything for you.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.